Lesson we talked about, we started to study structure and histological structure of salivary, large salivary glands, and we talked about different type of adsina. Adsina, let me remind you, adsina is a structural and functional unit of parenchymal salivary glands, and the adsina, depending on the type of cells which compose adsina, we can classify all of adsina to serous, mucous adsina, and mixed adsina, which has which have the myriones of Giannuzzi. Here you can see serous adsina, mucous adsina, and there are the myriones of Giannuzzi which make mixed adsina. So it's mixed adsina present both type of cells, serous and mucous cells, except serous cells except secretory portions. Next part of salivary glands is the Krohn's glands, the duct system. A duct system composes stroma on the salivary glands, and the serous and mucous cells produce secrete released by apical surface or lateral surfaces into first part of duct system, which is named intercalated duct. Let me explain you. Intercalated duct. Excuse me, I must. Intercalated duct, and the next part it's a striated duct, and okay, let's start from the intercalated duct. Intercalated duct is located within inside in the secretory part of the adsina. Here, it's more visible. So it's intercalated duct, which is a continue of the secretory part of the adsina. Lining epithelium is a simple cuboidal epithelium. Next part is the striated duct, which is composed by simple columnar epithelium. Why we call it striated duct? Because of presence of the basal striation in the basal part of the cell. Here you can see that nucleus in this cell is located in the middle part, and in the basic part you can see basal striation. Basal striation which created by deep folds of basic part of cell membrane of cells, and between these folds or evagination take place inside in the cytoplasm are located a lot of mitochondria. What is the function of this part of duct system of the salivary glands? If here present in the basic part so many mitochondria, it can tell about a possible effective transport of substances, and mostly it's a water to make large volume of the saliva. Because by secretory portion is produced only a little bit of serous or mucous secrete, but we can release a lot of saliva. Yes. So a main function of the striated duct, it's a transportation of water into the space of the striated duct to make volume, to increase volume of the saliva. Therefrom, we can get this water from the outside in connective tissue which contain blood vessel. From the blood, by draining through the basement membrane from the blood. Yes. And next part, it's the interlobular. And next one, it's the intralobular. And last one, it's the main duct. Here you can see that interlobular, it's covered, inside is covered by stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. A main duct of different part of salivary glands have different mandax, have different opening, different place of opening. For example, parotid glands, an opening of the main duct of parotid glands, it's the vestibule of the oral cavity in the region of the second molar. Opening of sublingual submandibular salivary glands, I mean main duct, it's the oral cavity propria under the tongue. Yes. So let's go to the next digestive gland, which is the pancreas. Structure of the pancreas. It's the first. Pancreas, it's the gland of both function, exocrine and endocrine. It's located in the epigastral region. It's the retroperitoneal organ. And which both function, let me remind you, exocrine and endocrine. Exocrine part take, produce about 1.5 liter of pancreatic juice per one day. And the endocrine part take about 1 or 2% and produce hormones by islets of Langerhans. Let's start from exocrine part. At the first pancreas, it's a parenchymal organ. It has stroma and parenchyma. Stroma made up of capsula, connective tissue capsula, which sends septa and divide parenchyma to two parts. And the smallest part with explained function and the structure of the exocrine part of the pancreas is named adsina, pancreatic adsina, like in the salivary glands. Salivary adsina and pancreatic adsina have similar structure, but they have a lot of differences. We will tell about them. And the structural and functional unit of the endocrine part, it's the islet of Langerhans. Adsina, structure of the pancreatic adsina. Pancreatic adsina made up of adsina cells and centroadsina cells, and the pancreatic adsina don't contain any other type of cells like myoepithelial cells in the salivary glands. If you remember, accessory cells in salivary adsinas, there are myoepithelial cells, very helpful for releasing of secretin to the intercalated ducts. By contraction, they help to release secrete from apical surfaces of serous and mucous cells to intercalated ducts. Pancreatic adsina don't have myoepithelial cells. And pancreatic adsina cells have pyramidal shape. They have a round shape nucleus in the middle part of the cell. And here, pay attention. And the middle part contain of the cytoplasm contain nucleus organelles and greatly developed rough endoplasmic reticulum which is the basic staining structure. So in the slide with the staining with hematoxylin and eosin, basic part of adsina cells has a blue, dark blue color, basophilic. And apical part contains zymogenic granules, which made up of enzymes which compose pancreatic juice. So, and they are zymogenic, so apical part of cell stain with eosine and has pink color. So cells, Acina cells, are polychromatophilic. Polychromatophilic, it means they have a pink color in apical part and have a dark blue color in the basic part. So both colors because of presence of zymogenic granules in apical part. Next difference from salivary glands is it. Do you have any question? Next difference that between cells, Acina cells, and absent intercellular intercellular duct. In salivary Acina, they present, and they are pancreatic Acina, they are absent. So it's impossible the releasing of secret of Acina cells through lateral surfaces. Lateral surfaces of cells, they are connected by intercellular junction, and all of surfaces are connected very close to each other, and space is absent because we don't need a lot of pancreatic juice. And next, about duct system. First part of duct system is the intercalated duct. And next one, interlobular, extralobular main duct, and absent striated ducts. Here in the pancreatic duct system, absent striated part, unlike to salivary. Exocrine, yes. Exocrine. Yes. What about zymogenic granules? Zymogenic granules of Acina cells contain zymogenic enzymes. They are inactive. They can be activated only in the space of the intestine. So, at the first, Acina cells release secrete of components of zymogenic granules into intercalated duct, and one by one till main duct. And the main duct carries these substances into duodenum. If you remember before entering to the duodenum, to the standard part of the duodenum, we have fusion of the ductus choledochus and the main and pancreatic duct together, with formation of the ampulla duodenum pancreatica. And this ampulla has opening in the descending part of the middle wall of the descending part of the duodenum, which is named papilla duodeni major. So only in the space of the intestine, this zymogenic inactive enzyme of Acina cells can be activated and start work. As a part of the parenchyma or pancreas is the endocrine, which is explained by islets of Langerhans. Islets of Langerhans, they surrounded by connective tissue capsule. And this connective tissue capsule contains blood vessels. A lot of blood vessels present between cells which compose islets of Langerhans. And it's a difference of endocrine part from exocrine. Endocrine part doesn't have ducts, but it has, unlike to exocrine, it has greatly developed blood supply. Because cells of the islets of Langerhans produce hormones and release them into the blood. Which type of cells compose islets of Langerhans? First one, it's a beta cells. their name beta cells because of staining. They are basic staining or blue staining cells. Main function, they produce insulin. Insulin can decrease level of sugar in the peripheral blood. It increase open special canals, and so that sugar from the blood can enter to cells within necessary of the glucose, like muscle cells, like neurons, hepatocytes. And the next type of cells, alpha cells. Alpha cells here stained in the slide with staining with hematoxylin and eosin, like here the pink color alpha cells, they produce glucagon. Functionally, glucagon has opposite function to is opposite to insulin. It can increase level of the sugar in the peripheral blood by activation breaking of the glycogen in a hepatocyte of the liver. So hepatocyte accumulate glycogen and glucagon, increase breaking of the glycogen and releasing sugar into the blood. So that's the increased level of sugar in the peripheral blood. Next type of cells, delta cells, which produce somatostatin, which inhibit insulin and glucagon secretion. So target cells for somatostatin are alpha and beta cells of islets of Langerhans. It can regulate function of alpha and beta cells. So the cells delta cells have a paracrine secretion as they released to neighboring cells. They can be released not to the blood, to neighboring cells, for inflammation on beta and alpha cells which are located outside. And next type of cells, B1 cells, which secrete hormone, vasoactive intestinal peptide, which has an effect similar to glucagon. And last one, PP cells secrete hormone pancreatic polypeptide, which stimulates chief cells in gastric glands for secretion, chief cells for secretion, pepsinogen, secretion of pepsinogen, and inhibit bile and bicarbonate secretion. So it was about structure and function of parenchyma, two part of parenchyma of the pancreas. Next large digestive glands, it's the liver. Let's start from functions of the liver. It's the largest gland in the body, and it's the like laboratory of the organism. And except that it's during embryonic development, it's a hematopoietic organ. The functions, main function, it's a synthesis, and it has exocrine and endocrine secretion. So both types of secretion here present. Storage vitamins A, D, K, and iron. Detoxification of many drugs and toxins, and like alcohol, like hormone substances, like hormones happen here, happen detoxification all of substances. So how does it possible? A liver get blood from all of impaired organs of the digestive system, like stomach, small and large intestine, and get this blood through the vena porta. And vena porta brings the blood with filling different toxic substances that come here from the intestine and stomach for detoxication. And after detoxication, liver give it this clear blood back to the bloodstream. Metabolic functions, this synthesis of different substances, different metabolic substances like urea, like the different proteins, like glycogen synthesis and storage of glycogen, protective function, production of bile, it's an exocrine, very important exocrine function of the pancreas, of the liver, catabolism of hemoglobin from catabolism of hemoglobin, and it's a storage of blood and the accumulation of blood, because why it's possible, because liver has a lot of greater development venous system, and the liver has fenestrated capillaries, so possible accumulation of blood and storage of blood. If it's necessary, it can release this blood after bleeding into the bloodstream. And embryonic hematopoiesis. Liver is a parenchymal organ. Parenchymal organ, it has stroma and parenchyma. Let's start from the stroma. Stroma of the liver is composed by connective tissue capsule which send septa and divide parenchyma to structural and functional units. As the first, it's there are lobules, after the segments, and then finally they have hepatic lobules. But sometimes you can meet different name of different structural and functional units. It can be portal lobule, it can be hepatic acina, but most useful it's a hepatic lobule, hexagonal or liver lobule, hexagonal shape, liver lobule. Portal lobule is a triangular shape, and acina is a rhomboid shape. And here in this picture you can see slide with staining with hematoxylin and eosin, and you can see bodies of hexagonal structural and functional unit, which is a hepatic lobule. It's a connective tissue. If you remember, capsule sends septa and divide parenchyma to different part till structural and functional unit. So here you can see this septa with a branches of the connective tissue capsule. Connective tissue capsule is very of the liver is very thick. It contains a lot of receptors. And the receptors, pain receptors and other type of receptors in the liver present only in elements of the parenchyma. And we can feel pain in the liver only in a pathological situation, pathological cases, if we have increasing of the volume of the liver. What about structure of the hepatic lobule? Hexagonal shape structure which contain inside in the center is contain a central vein. In corners present hepatic triad. Which composed by interlobular vein, interlobular artery, interlobular bile duct. Here, green color, it's interlobular bile duct. Blue color, interlobular vein, and red color, interlobular artery. Interlobular artery, it's a branch, the finished branch of the hepatic artery, and which carry arterial blood. Oxygenated blood. Interlobular vein, it's a branch of the portal vein which carry an oxygenated blood, venous blood, which fill in different toxic substances. If you remember, liver get venous blood by a portal vein from all and pierce organs of the digestive system. And bile duct and the both interlobular artery and interlobular vein carry blood from outside, from peripheral part of the hepatic lobules to the central part. Yes, and only bile duct carry bile from the central part to outside, has opposite direction. Both type of blood vessels carry blood to one capillaries, which is a sinusoidal capillaries. So sinusoidal capillaries carry blood to what? To the central vein. Central vein, after detoxification of the blood by hepatocytes, carry blood outside and from the carry blood from the liver by hepatic veins. Hepatic veins about four hepatic veins, and venous blood from hepatic veins enter to the vena cava inferior. And so you must remember that sinusoidal capillaries contain, students, please stop talking or switch on a voice. Sinusoidal capillaries contain mixed blood, both blood vessels, it's a venous and arterial blood, carry blood together in one capillary. Sinusoidal capillaries contain mixed blood. That's only one organ in the human body which has blood vessels with mixed blood. And here you can see that parenchyma of the hepatic lobules composed by cord rows, it's the elongated structure which made up of hepatocytes. So hepatocyte, it's a cell, it's the smallest structural unit of the parenchyma of the liver. It hexagonal shape like hepatic lobule. It has nucleus. It can have more than one nucleus. It more than one nucleolus. It has a greatly developed, smooth and rough endoplasmic reticulum. A lot of mitochondria. It needs a lot of mitochondria, a lot of energy for synthetic process and for detoxification. And it has the peroxisomes, lysosomes, and it has two surfaces, functional surfaces. The surface which close to sinusoidal capillaries is named vascular surface, and this space between wall of capillaries and the vascular surface is a space of Disset. Space of Disset contains three interesting type of cells, which are Kupffer cells, Ito cells, and Pitt cells. Kupffer cells, they are microphages, the antigen presentation cells, they are very helpful from for immunity, and they take place in the space of DSM. Next type of cells, they are Pitt cells, they are nature killers, they are located here, and Ito cells for accumulation of vitamin A, storage vitamin A. Opposite surface to vascular surface is the biliary surface. Biliary surface of the hepatocytes composed wall of the bile duct, bile capillaries. Bile capillaries doesn't have its own walls. Walls of capillaries made up of biliary surfaces of two neighboring hepatocytes. And by biliary surface, hepatocytes release bile, which they produce and release here. Bile capillaries, it's like slits, thin slits between two neighboring biliary surfaces of hepatocytes. Here. It's about hepatocyte, and let me explain you. Look here. During exam, you can get a slide like this slide, and the end question: which liver is it? Is it human or not? Here isn't human liver. It has the greatly developed septa between neighboring greatly developed septa between neighboring hepatic lobule. It's the liver of pig. In human liver, we don't have so greatly developed septa. Septa invisible. You can see only hepatic triad in corners of the hepatic lobule. Here you can see only triad. Let me find and show you. I don't have here. I cannot explain you just. So it's a central vein here. You can see. No, it's not good example. I promise you next lecture to explain you a human liver, because here is absent. Yes.